Hey folks! Alright, this is a request from the lab students. Because they're feeling under pressure. Hopefully I don't get flagged for copyright on this song. They heard me. The YouTubers heard me. Okay, let's do it. All right, get that out of here. That's clear. And then, so now we're gonna pick up with this and start getting into spectroscopy. And specifically, we're gonna start just with atomic spectroscopy. And as we get, as we progress more through the semester, we're gonna get more specific with techniques, with molecules, different wavelengths of light, etc. Okay, so but the first thing to talk about is how we see the connection of the quantum numbers with spectroscopy. Okay, so we will define a spectroscopic transition as some set of initial quantum numbers that describes an initial state, right? Ni, Li, and Li. And this transitions, of course, to some final state. And if on these quantum numbers, F is less than I, particularly for N, and I'll say for N, then light will be emitted, okay? So, of course, if I is greater than F for N, then light will be required to be absorbed for that transition to happen, okay? So something that we're all probably pretty familiar with, energy must be conserved in a spectroscopic transition, okay? So what that means is if we transition from one state to the next, so let's say that's our initial and that's our final, right? We know that there's an energy difference between those two states, and via conservation of energy, the light that gets emitted has to have the same energy as the difference between these two states. Similarly, if light is absorbed, right, for the case of if I is greater than F, then the light that is being absorbed has to have the same energy as the difference between the two levels, okay? So that's conservation of energy. And so the change in energy of the electron must be compensated by an emitted or absorbed photon, right? So remember, this is an electron that's going through different states, okay? Something that's less talked about in spectroscopy, at least up until now in your education, angular momentum must also be conserved in a spectroscopic transition. So we have to have conservation of energy and conservation of momentum, okay? So, recall, we have this angular momentum equation, right, for our magnitude, total magnitude, s times s plus 1 times h bar, okay? And so, for a photon, s equals 1, and that's the only possible quantum number for a photon. So, all photons have root 2 h bar angular momentum for s equal to 1, right? 1 times 1 plus 1 is 2, okay? So what this means is total angular momentum must be conserved in a spectroscopic transition. Therefore, the change in angular momentum must be compensated for the angular momentum removed by a photon. So for example, if an atom undergoes this type of transition, where it goes from a high energy state to a low energy state and emits light as a result, that light is going to be removing energy from the molecule, right? And that energy comes from the transition from an excited state to a ground state. But that photon is also going to be taking angular momentum along with it. Even though photons are massless, they do have angular momentum, as stated right here. Photons have no mass. However, it was showed by Dirac using relativistic quantum mechanics that photons are described with an intrinsic spin quantum number equal to 1. So that's s equals 1. Okay. So when a photon gets emitted, It's removing angular momentum from that atom. And what that means is when the electron also goes through that transition, it has to compensate that loss of angular momentum. Okay? So for example, suppose we make a transition from a d orbital down to an s orbital. And we won't worry about what n level we're at, because as it turns out, n doesn't give us angular momentum, it's L, right? That's important. And specifically, we're just gonna do this for ML equal to zero for both states to make this an easier discussion. So we're talking about, you know, a dz squared orbital down to an s orbital, okay? So now, if we were to calculate the electron angular momentum, right, we know L is equal to 2. So 2 plus 1 is 3 times 2. That's going to be root 6 h bar, all right? And for when it makes this transition to go to the s orbital, L is equal to 0, so that's going to be 0 angular momentum. But there's also an emitted photon as a result, right? Because if it's going from a higher energy to a lower energy, we've got L2 goes to L1 plus h nu, right? A photon is emitted, okay? And so that's going to be plus an additional root 2 h bar. And so as you can see right here, root 6 h bar does not equal root 2 h bar. So as a result, this is a forbidden transition, okay? So we can't go from a d orbital to an s orbital. Can't be done. And that gives us our first selection rule for all hydrogenic atoms. And by hydrogenic atoms, we're really meaning the simple atoms, okay? So we can't do an L2 to L0. What about an L1 to an L0? Could I do it? Okay, well, when L is equal to 1, that's root 2 h bar. Beautiful. And when L is equal to 0, we know that that's 0. However, a photon is getting emitted as a result. So there's a root 2 h bar angular momentum leaving from the photon. So root 2 h bar equals root 2 h bar. And thus, we can go from L equals 1 to L equals 0, okay? So this delta L must be plus or minus 1, but additionally, okay, ML must equal 0 or plus or minus 1. And I haven't shown that through this simple math right here. However, the result of this ML equals 0 plus or minus 1 has to do with the transition dipole moment. So the dipole moment that's created when that electron transitions through a different state, okay? So let's look at that next.